Over a course of 40 minutes, you will have the ball in your hand about 90 seconds. That's inarguable. That's not my opinion. That's a fact. What are you doing for us the other minutes that you're out on the floor?
I can't remember, like, not playing basketball. And I guess as far as, you know, being a college basketball player, it just seemed like the logical thing to do. I mean,
growing up in Northfield, we always came to the games here, especially Carleton St. Olaf games, football and basketball. So now when I get a chance to actually play, it's pretty exciting.
Come on, baby, you better make a start. You better make it soon before you break my heart.
I remember us having a lot of wild ideas about this whole thing. We were setting out to make the great American sports documentary. Even though, when we started, we could barely even fit the camera to its tripod. But as we followed this team game by game and practice by practice, we learned that to truly understand what goes on in an entire season, you need to become intimate with each of its parts. And what began as a detached observance of others wound up more as an inward look at ourselves.
Catch and shoot. You two guys do the switch too. Jim, just go and shallow cut X. Ready? Play.
I don't think there's four people that really understand the emotion, the effort, the determination, the commitment, the time consumption that goes in to a successful basketball program, particularly at a place like Carleton, where you're looking at trying to recruit a kid that needs to be in the maybe top 5 or 6% of their class and having some way to come up with $25,000 a year, which will mean, you know, $100,000, and getting a February 1st application deadline in, which the enormity of what goes on from November through, you know, May and finishing off recruiting and that kind of stuff. And I don't construe that as whining. I knew, you know, all of that coming in, and I don't need a whole lot of other people on campus to understand that other than my athletic director and hopefully the dean and stuff like that. But
as we prepared to film, we wondered, when does a basketball season truly begin? To say that it begins with the first practice is perhaps naive. Coaches will tell you that with recruiting, one season begins as soon as the previous one ends. But we had to start somewhere. So with a month of nothing but practices and scrimmages before the first real game, we roll camera. What we found out, and what you are about to see, is truly more than you know.
So my season started for me on October 16th when Coach Carleton said, you know, we have a spot open. If you still want to play, come down for the first practice. It was kind of a shock to my system because I wasn't playing. So it's been hard for me to get in shape and do the things that I'm used to doing without that off-season work.
There is no off-season for basketball. It's unlike most other sports where you have to play year-round. I mean, we're going to be playing this winter with the games, and then this spring we started up practicing again, just captain's practices. And then summer we play, fall we play, and then the winter starts up again.
Trying to integrate what we've been working on converting and matching, right?
with the fast break stuff that we want to do.
The team dynamics began to develop with the running of the first scrimmage, where the freshmen could show off their skills and the upperclassmen could show how they'd improved over the last season.
Let's do it, everybody. Let's get it done. Stuff.
D.
Let's go. Be quick. Here we go. Back and we'll come back. It's a good start, everybody.
Good job
here, Carleton. It's a good start. You'll have different teams when we come back in. Tough D.
Wasn't bad at all. Yeah, one thing I really...
Go ahead, Sam.
I taped it and it hurts on the heel now.
Okay, go tell him what you need fixed. Yeah, he'll do it.
Point guards, when they're coming down, you know, we're working so hard to get the ball inside. And the first time, I mean, just right when we get down the floor, our posts are not spotting up on the block, and our point guards are not looking at us that initial thing.
The initial look off the drive, you mean?
We've got total isolation right off the start.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time on that, too, yesterday, but that's a good point. Let's make that
and Jake especially is not, you know, getting a good spot on the block. They're not making for
they're
the ball.
Just not
and then the point guards are looking to their secondary stuff and not looking at
that's right. They're real casual about first one. Yeah, well, that's good observation. That's right. I can see that in retrospect.
First question I'd like to ask you really is, one of the questions we're going to pose to the camera is, when exactly does the season begin?
I would say for me, probably at Carleton, it begins about the time when my previous season wraps up and we're heading to the Final Four, because that's about the time that we find out we've been accepted to Carleton as far as our new, you know, recruits coming in and establishing somewhat of a depth chart. And then that's the Final Four is always really a glitter basketball time of the year anyway, so you're pretty up and your season's over, so you have kind of a distant warmth about you, you know, from the season, you know, being packaged and done and in the record books, and then starting to anticipate what's going to be coming up in the following year. So I would say, yeah, the first week of April.
No matter the opinion on when a season begins, there's a consensus that preseason, while monotonous, is nevertheless a heady time. The Carleton program was in the midst of a 5-year string of playoff appearances, although they had lost in the first round each of those 5 years. But now, led by two senior captains, Tom Klimisch and Ken Coblin, the team felt that this was their year.
I would have to start with Tom Klimisch. Tom is a 6'8 forward from Northfield that we recruited 4 years ago, hard to believe, and has just done a great job of getting into the system, working hard on the offseason to the point where I believe he would be a legitimate Division II player this year in most of the programs in the NCC. To not inflate Tom just because he's my player, I could tell you this. He was one of only three players last year that the coaches voted on the first ballot of all conference. In other words, he received 11 first votes from every single one of the coaches. And there were only two other players that had that distinction, and they were the co-MVPs of the league, Brent Longville from St. Thomas and Travis Weiss from St. John.
While Tom was one of the area's most sought-after recruits, the other captain, Ken Coblin, was hardly noticed coming out of his hometown of Iowa City.
There's a whole chunk of high school players who are really good high school players like Ken was, but if you're kind of casual about the game, it's very tough to compete at the college level unless you're really exceptional. Ken is very, very good. but he just loves the game so much and works so hard and lifts weights and does all that kind of stuff that we don't feel that we're going to come off from what we had as far as Ken being a three-man for us last year. The last one-third of the season, we felt he was playing as well as any perimeter player that we had, you know, on our team, and we lost three real solid seniors last year.
As the season progressed, we watched closely how Tom and Ken handled the pressures of being captains of a college basketball team.
At this point, fall term is nearing its end, but the preseason rolls on, 5 or 6 days a week, 2 to 3 hours a day. Yet there is light at the end of the tunnel. In a week, the team will make its biannual preseason journey to Los Angeles and Honolulu. Also, the physical intensity of practice tapers. But the mental load increases. It is exam time, and at a school which produces more PhDs in the laboratory sciences per capita than any other in the nation, the stress in the library is greater than the stress in the gym. Priorities become obvious.
It is 20 minutes before the hour. With the school year just underway, a lot of young men and women and their families are thinking about college. And U.S. News and World Report has helped in the form of its 9th annual guide to America's best colleges. It is especially important at a time when a college education can cost as much as a small house, $100,000 for a four-year average. And the guide's executive editor, Mel Elfin, joins us this morning. Good morning. Welcome.
Good morning.
Congratulations. What an undertaking.
It's a lot of data points to sort out.
Well, one of the things you also try to measure is the teaching capacity of individual institutions, which I imagine is a pretty subjective thing to measure. Who topped the list?
Well, very subjective. We asked college presidents and deans which schools they think they thought did the absolute best job of teaching as opposed to research or any of the other factors that go into making a great college. What goes on in the classroom? What is the learning process like? Who does the best job? And Dartmouth came out as number one in the university category. And if you've ever seen any movies in the 40s, it was always Dartmouth because it has that atmosphere. It has a very small faculty to student ratio. And it's so isolated up there that you it's easier to study in that area in Hanover.
You also measured the teaching abilities of teachers at national liberal arts colleges.
Right.
Topping that list is Carleton College, followed by Swarthmore and Williams.
There's no surprises here. Carleton College for years has been sending more of its students on who get to get PhDs, and they do get the PhDs in any other liberal arts college in the country. And this means that they must have emphasized somewhere the teaching process, and they must have inspired many of their students to become teachers because of the atmosphere and the leadership of the school.
Be able to hit a counter that they're not going to pick up. That's an objective anyway. But
in most of these sense,
but the students aren't the only ones at Carleton who are doing their homework.
The game. Either we're walking the ball off the floor or
sure.
After a timeout or
yep.
Whatever.
Yep. Yeah.
That wouldn't be hard, you know, just to mention to Tom, Nick, whoever's in there, to repeat the call.
That's
the
right.
Guy's down in the baseline.
We've done that in the past with our wings okay. Coming down. Sure, that's a good idea. Yeah. I want the communication system to be consistent and understood, and I'm not so sure it's just not the fact that they are a little confused with the plays in the different sets right now, as opposed because it's early. And I'm not totally convinced that we're going to be using all of them, particularly Dan, like I talked to you about on our first game, how much, you know, that's the tape that we send to all of our opponents. Not only do we feel that we need to run all of that stuff, but do we wish to choose to run all that stuff? I told Dan the extreme could be
at all.
One of the night's key players would be 6'9 sophomore center Nick Brown of Madison, Wisconsin, who as a freshman was third in the nation in blocked shots. His very presence in the low post would be central to Carleton's achieving its high goals for the year.
Early on, no one knew exactly how to react around us or our camera, a fact only amplified by an early AM flight.
Gentlemen, you have any thoughts before heading onto the plane between mouthfuls of tunnels?
A little too early for this.
Linda? How many of these trips have you taken before?
Oh, gosh. This is the fourth one to Hawaii.
Uh-huh.
So, the first one we did was to California only.
It's wild, isn't it? Jimmy, say something smart.
Oh, I'm thinking. One giant step for man.
Nor did we know exactly how to set them at ease, inexperienced as we were. But there was a definite charge and anticipation in the air. After all, this team was about to play its first games.
Comments?
Do you have any pre-flight comments?
We can't wait to get over there and start playing ball.
It's going to be good.
All right, Joe.
Hi, Mom.
It's weird. I think it's very weird. In comparison to last year's, practices are nowhere near as intense. We do so much less running. I don't know. I'm confused.
Does that make you nervous that you?
Yeah, I'm not sure what to expect from it. You know, if that's gonna hurt us or help us.
Bye-bye.
Good
day.
It seems like Coach is doing a lot more teaching this year. And I don't know. I guess we need it because, you know, we're planning on playing some really good freshmen, but they're kind of raw like every freshman is. And so I guess it just seems kind of inordinate that we spend so much time coaching. Usually we come out of practices just feeling horrible. And I don't know. I guess I kind of miss it, you know. I just kind of expect to have my day ruined, in a sense. And since that isn't happening, I'm a little concerned.
People probably think we're famous.
You guys want to give me your thoughts on coming to California and playing within... Then, I don't know, 10 minutes of finding your hotel?
I was hoping we could get something to eat.
I know.
Think again, boys.
If preseason is the tuition, the four tough games on this road trip are the test. Questions of strategy and personnel must be answered here before conference play begins. More importantly, here is where a roster of men becomes a team. Personalities are on this trip flushed out, and team chemistry is formed. So, while most of the players are simply enthralled about the prospects of fun and sun, they are also learning about themselves. For me, since my partner Ryan needed to stay home, I was alone to learn along with them.
So, Jordan, how do you feel about going to Disneyland, man?
Oh, man. Can't explain it.
So excited.
Yeah. I didn't catch the blink of a spot over LA.
No, don't look at that.
Nice bug though.
Sunny days, sweeping up, clouds away. On the way to where the air is sweet. Won't you tell me how to get? Man, play, everything's a-okay. Friendly neighbors and that's when we'll meet. Won't you tell me how to get out of the ghetto?
Chad Boger is the starting point guard for the team. The enthusiasm and spontaneity that he shows when interacting with his friends is also a fair indication of how he plays on the court.
First would be Chad Boger. He broke into our starting lineup in about the last third
of the season, and was one of the reasons that we were propelled into the playoffs. He is a quarterback, and I mean from peripheral vision to distributing the basketball to all that kind of stuff. He's just puts an inordinate amount of pressure on the defense, because when he has the ball, if you're asleep for a half a step on defense, your man has the ball and he scored, or you're fouling him or something like that. I haven't coached a player. I believe Chad Boulder will be the finest guard who has ever played for me at Carleton. And he doesn't play nervous. He's out of successful high school.
Oh, man.
We're in Disneyland.
Pretty excited about
real
that.
Excited.
There's nothing after day walking, getting out on the court for a little while.
Hour of running around, just shooting it. They're gonna love it. As long as you don't sweat too much.
Oh, hey.
Trolley!
Train coming, yeah.
Watch out. Jolly trolley.
My legs are about screwed right now, so this two-hour practice will probably just add to it. We'll probably be, I don't know, dead for tomorrow's game.
Eric Furch is one of four talented freshmen. His quick, aggressive defense and sharp perimeter shooting in the preseason earned him a starting position at the number two spot.
We're shooting tonight.
Yeah, we get to shoot.
It's awesome.
How long has it been since you've shot last?
I forgot how.
Yeah, when was the last time I shot?
I don't know.
Six times, baby.
Scope it all the way around. Make sure you get a good shot of me.
Only 45 minutes to go.
I don't.
Smile at some, Jim. What's your name?
Michelle.
Where are you from?
Sacramento.
Sacramento,
woo! I'm here at a softball tournament.
How long a drive is that?
Where you guys from? 7 hours.
Minnesota. That was pretty nice of Sam, you know.
You're pretty smooth at all, but you don't have to like lose the group and all that good stuff.
Yeah. I mean, we still all have to leave at 5. Yeah. What, is he planning on a hitching ride with them or something? I don't know.
Hope you hook us up with some friends or something at least, Sam.
Go, Freezer! Go girls in college! Yeah!
Here we are!
We got it! Oh, that was nice.
Ready, everyone, alakazam together? Yeah. Yes! Pull, Michael! Pull! Yes! Oh! You got it! He's coming! Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you our temporary ruler of the realm, King Michael!
Oh my God! Love dog with me.
Oh,
man, how many people do
that? I should have made a movie.
Are you ready?
Disneyland has offered the team an enjoyable diversion from basketball. Yet it has been a very long Thanksgiving day.
Hey, Sam, relax.
For Jake Nelson, who turned his ankle in practice the night before, this day probably seemed especially long. So, with mind and body wearied from amusement, the team leaves for a quick dinner and then a practice. Day dawned to Carleton's first real test of the young season, a PM showdown with local favorite Claremont McKenna.
We need just a real veteran effort, a mid-season effort from a perimeter standpoint, and if we don't get that, it's not going to be a contest tonight.
I understand you have an important assignment today. Can you tell me who you're guarding and what his strengths are?
I'm guarding a guy named Zitar, Z-I-T-A-R. It sounds like a bigger Russian name. I played him last year. He's 6'5". He's really tough. He's probably one of the best centers that I'll ever play against in terms of pure centers and strength. My job is to keep him off the boards and to not let him score a lot of points. And by doing that, I'm going to have help from Nick and Jake and Adam. They're all going to help me beat this guy up. But it's going to be a heck of a challenge because he was all-conference as a sophomore last year. And this year he's a junior, he's bigger, stronger, better, but so am I.
That's the real sales pitch as far as being the constant of what we think we need to do to be competitive. And we've finished first in the MIAC the last 2 years in defensive field goal percentage, and I don't think that's by accident. I think we teach it hard, the kids take it to task, and that's got to be our identity, you know, for the early season ball games, and certainly need that carryover going into a tough MIAC schedule.
Just like that, exactly 1 month after the first practice, the Carleton basketball season began. I was eager to see how this team, possessed of such talent and seemingly of such chemistry, would respond. Also, how would I respond to the challenge of filming my first game? So I watched from my dispassionate viewfinder as the quick, physical Claremont McKenna Stags jumped on the nights early and never looked back. And though Carleton played hard and had some fine performances, on this night, it just couldn't close the gap.
Yeah,
to see how much difficulty they have against your defense when you force them to the baseline. Ken, I don't know what you're thinking or not thinking when you're out there, but you're not playing our defense.
I've done films for a couple of years now, and it's always a humbling experience because, you know, we always laugh, but the film is the evidence, but there's no denying what you did on the court, because the coach has an opportunity to look at what you did, and he, in his, to quote him, his answers his questions about his players. And there's really nothing you can say when you see yourself making a mistake on the film other than, damn it, it's time to get better. And, you know, for me, I kind of dread film sessions because, well, I know what's about to happen. It's, you know, I know I've gotten to the point. When I was a freshman, I wasn't even sure what I was doing wrong. But now I understand the program and the ideas. And it's, I guess it makes it even more disappointing when you know you've made a mistake and you know when it's coming on the film. So, I think for the freshman, it might have been kind of an eye-opening experience, to say the least.
We just think the level of the ball, Eric. 1 of 5 steals.
You're an inexperienced team. Did you think teams inexperienced? I mean, you have a lot of young players. Maybe as a team you're not that inexperienced. But do you think some of the younger players, some of the inexperienced on the team, had any effect on yesterday's game? Or do you think it was kind of a team win?
Well, you know, to be quite honest, I think that the freshmen really were the better players, you know, last night. I know I didn't have a stellar game by any means. And certainly don't mean to single anyone out, but Chad did not play like we need him to play to be a winning team in the MIAC. So with the defensive performance by Eric was incredible, in my opinion. And all around, the ability of all of our freshmen to be in the spots that they were supposed to be was very impressive. But not only that, but Eric had, you know, something kind of, I don't know how to describe it other than special. He had his hand on every ball, and that was really an impressive thing for me. So I thought that our freshmen had quite a showing. And, tonight we're going to have to see some more senior leadership, some more from the older guys.
One of the freshmen, guard Sam Richardson, is like Tom Klimisch, a product of Northfield. His smooth charm and flair is matched only by his athletic talent. In addition to basketball, Sam was also a star free safety and quarterback in high school. He could have played either, if not both, in college.
High reversal. Point at the top. Remember now, we're not up at the elbow here. We're more at the medium post, high post, correct? When I get it back at the top, what's my first look right now? Into the gut, right?
Right, Jim.
Do we have to go to the passing end, actually, how the ball gets reversed to the...
Where are you at? 3 men?
Yeah.
With a buzz cut and a jump shot straight from a textbook, freshman forward Jim Lovren of Faribault reminds you a lot of Jimmy Chitwood, the guy in the film Hoosiers who never missed a shot. Along with Richardson, Lovren would start the year as a key reserve. After basketball season, Jim will join the Carleton baseball squad as a pitcher.
Where's the ball? Here?
Five.
Five's got it?
Yeah.
You're contesting.
Gets with you.
Yep. And now he comes and you're just going to get in his pocket right here. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah. Because he would shoot for three.
No, we're not staying down. We're not staying down here. We're contesting, and he's going to go hard. But, you know, you'll be fine. You get him right into the basket line, and you're just going to park right here. So we got some help over there. And then you know what's coming after that.
Okay, how does starting the season with a loss change the team's perspective?
Well, I'd say, you know, it shouldn't be a big surprise, I guess, we're playing away on an away court. I don't know, I think that tonight is, you know, you can chalk it up to enthusiasm to really do well again, but tonight is really going to show our ability to bounce back and to see how good we really are, because I don't think we're going to have the same type of mental mistakes. It's going to be more of an athletic contest tonight. I think it's really important that we show well. You know, it's not even just playing well. I really think we need to win, because, you know, we could conceivably come back from this trip 0-4. And just something about that is unsettling to me. You know, we've never done well in the preseason. We always schedule teams that are, you know, a little bit out of our league, but we've always come back with a win. And I think that's going to have to be tonight.
Against Pomona Pitzer, a highly regarded academic school much like Carleton College, the Knights found themselves in a hard-fought battle. Freshman Eric Furch and sophomore Nick Brown, both of whom would later be named to the all-tournament team, were outstanding. Yet neither team could keep a lead. After a game of furious twos and fro's, the final seconds were like from a B movie. So, with Carleton College down by one, the senior who so badly wanted to win took the shot that would decide the ball game.
Participants in the first annual Carleton Hawaii Parade.
King and Queen.
In Hawaii, Carleton will face its toughest tests all year, against two nationally ranked NAIA Division I schools. Keeping with tradition, the first practice on Oahu is anything but paradise.
Direct turnovers that we can't defend.
You're looking without free throws at a team making five field goals on you because they had most of their points on free throws. That pressure is good. What we need to do is complement that by taking better care of the ball. Point again. When I am coming up.
Can you make some big plays?
Yeah.
Hey, all right. Now make it there.
The Knights make the trip to Hawaii every other year, and while sand and surf is part of the deal, each time they come, Coach Colland brings the team to the USS Arizona Memorial. As I found out, it's not just to kill time.
The radar had detected the Japanese strike force. At 7:48 a.m., they hit Kaneohe Bay Naval Air Station. Fort Island Naval Air Station, dive bombers tore apart the seaplanes and their hangars. The radio operator banged out a desperate message. Air raid Pearl Harbor, this is not drill. Then, their torpedo planes struck.
Yeah, he was in the war. After the Japanese attacked here, they moved immediately to the Pacific area of the Philippines. My dad was stationed in Manila. That's in the Philippines, and shortly thereafter, the Japanese attacked and eventually captured that entire force. And it was bad. In the beginning, they marched these men about 100 miles, maybe a little less. Very little food, very little water. In the Philippines, if you know anything about their climate, it gets 100 degrees by 7 in the morning and high humidity. So a lot of those guys didn't make it. So when you see something like this, if you had somebody that was involved in the war, it's a little more meaning to it, a little more emotional. So, it's always... I guess it's a thrill to visit this memorial each time we come, but it's an emotional place for me and for a lot of other people.
Pacific University had been ranked as high as number 2 in the NAIA Division I poll and featured two All-Americans in their starting five. Carleton would have to face HPU without the services of Nick Brown, who'd fallen ill. This would put added pressure on senior Tom Klemisch and on juniors Adam Mickelson and Jake Nelson, who split time at forward in replacing Brown. Mickelson, a 6'5 forward from Bloomington, wouldn't lead the Knights in scoring in any single game in 1995, but he was the kind of scrappy, steady leader every team needs. At 6'4", 215 pounds, junior Jake Nelson looked like a linebacker and had the strength to play that way. Nelson hadn't played as a sophomore, but came back this year to give back to basketball and to take from it whatever he could. In this game, he was matched against HPU's All-American forward, known only as Strickland. Nelson was tough, but at times overmatched. Carleton was tougher than HPU could have ever expected. But the Sea Warriors All-American point guard had a response to every Carleton rally. In the end, with Carleton's chances slipping away, freshman Jordan McIntyre and junior Brett Adelman each got a chance to strut their stuff on the Blaisdell Center hardwood. Jordan, a California native, had not played for his local high school team, but had instead sharpened his skills playing pickup games in neighborhood parks. Jordan's talent was quickly recognized at Carleton, and he was recruited for the team. Brett, a product of East Coast Queens, found himself first in Midwestern Nice, Minnesota, and now was far away as sunny Hawaii. He seemed just as wide-eyed as I was during the whole experience. The next day and a half would offer the team a chance to savor Oahu's attractions.
I can see clearly now the rain has gone. I can see all obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark clouds that had me blind. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. I think I can make it now, the pain has gone. All of the bad feelings have disappeared. Here is the rainbow I've been praying for. It's gonna be a bright, 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 bright sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, bright, bright sunshiny day. Look out around, there's nothing but blue skies. Blue straight ahead, nothing but blue skies. I can see clearly now the rain has gone. I can see all the obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark clouds that had me blind. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, 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 sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, bright, bright.
Well, everyone's gonna turn around. Everyone's gonna face the musicians. Ready, begin. One. Come on,
You don't find being in Hawaii a distraction at all?
A distraction in what way? I mean,
just distracted from the task at hand, that is to go out and play some.
Well, yeah, I think it.
Basketball.
Well, I mean, I guess we do have to sort of, like when we get mad, oh, we have to go do this, we have to go do that. I mean, I guess we are here to play basketball, and I guess Hawaii is just a benefit, so I guess we just have to look at it that way, more than it's, I don't know.
Yeah.
With the return of a now healthy Nick Brown to the Carleton starting lineup, the Knights felt they could aggressively challenge Division I NAIA opponent BYU Hawaii. Yet it was the dead-eye shooting of co-captain Ken Coblin that helped Carleton forge to a first half lead.
In college in the first half, and behind the solid shooting of Ken Coblin with 19 points, and then Coblin came out for a few minutes, and then BYU Hawaii went on that 12-2 run to get back in the ball game. So things will be heating up before this one is over here in Laie.
BYU Hawaii came back strong in the second half, however, and quickly built a lead Carleton couldn't surmount.
Miller keeping it alive.
Shots that fell for the Knights in the first half were now dropping for the Seasiders. Led by Nick, Carleton once again played hard, but the team with the size, numbers, and scholarships pulled away in the end. Carleton was left with memories, lessons, suntans, and a 1-3 record to take back to Minnesota.
Yeah.
How do you feel about being home?
I want to be back in Hawaii.
It's cold. I want to go to bed.
Tom?
This sucks. I'm shivering. I'm bringing out the jeans, dude. It's cold.
How do you feel about being home?
I usually do it about 7 in the morning. I want a nap.
How do you feel about being home?
It's too early, Chris. Get out of here. I'm about to pull a Sean Penn.
Upon returning from Hawaii, upwards of 40% of the basketball season is chronologically complete. Yet 80% of the games on the schedule still lie ahead. I welcome the team back, envious of their suntans, on the night of the first game on the conference schedule. There was an electricity about the team on this night. This is why preseason is played, why practices are so hard. From here on out, every game is essential.
This is it. The waiting's over. Let's go. This is what we've been planning for since day one. Let's get it done. Top D!
Control the boards now, Tom. Quick start.
Come on, nice. Chad.
Control the boards.
Down. Ball's up trying to get a lineup. Let's go get a couple layups in and bring it over to the bench.
We got the boards, Nick.
Minute and a half.
Good luck, coach.
Gustavus Adolphus College was one of the league favorites coming into the game. But Carleton was a tough team as well. Coach Collins had taken one of the smaller schools in the 11-team MIAC, and the one with the highest academic standards, and had fashioned them into a perennial contender. A third-place conference finish and fifth straight conference playoff appearance from the year before could only be improved upon, according to this team. The goal, the controlling factor all year, would be to get to the playoffs once again, and this time to come back with a win.
Hey, guys! Eric,
jump down, Eric.
Job, Eric.
With solid man-to-man defense and several blocks from Nick, Carleton held the Gusties scoreless for the first several minutes of the ball game. But then Gustavus swingman Steve Gillis dipped himself in gasoline, lit a match, and the game was on. By halftime, Gustavus had taken the lead.
Let's play behind, so our guys aren't so conscious. Dropping.
Well, the last two jump shots they hit, we were behind them, and Ken sank. We just came out.
I don't think we should go behind them.
And Tom, if you're in the lineup, Jake, if you're in the lineup and you've got the Gillis kid, we've got wherever the ball is, we've got to know where our triangle is off exchanges and stuff, and he's not going to put it on the floor. We just got to show, right? Not so tight that when he drives, I'm going to follow him, but I'm going to be standing in a position right here, and he's not going to be able to get a shot off. Done? Ken, everybody, when the ball...
That big on the ball, square wing! Square wing!
Despite the halftime coaching, Carleton still couldn't cool down Gillis. He finished 8 for 10 on the night from beyond the three-point arc. Finally, with Adam Mickelson now guarding Gillis, the Knights started to rally. It was a foreshadowing of how they would often play throughout the year. In the end, it was a freshman, forward Jim Lovren, who hit 2 key shots, and the Knights went on to win their first conference game.
Three nights later at St. John's, traditionally a tough place to play, partly because of its odd plastic floor and mostly because of its row of rowdy fans that taunt the opposition, Carleton lacked the intensity it had shown in rallying to beat Gustavus. And though they led at the half, the Knights simply couldn't hold back what proved to be a mediocre team from St. John's in the latter half of the ballgame.
How many times do we try to do too much too soon when we're on offense, when we're trying to run something and get the ball? That's just, we are a very immature team right now. You know, just flat out immature in the parts of the game that are going to make a difference. And I don't mean bad by immature, I mean not mature. You know, and it's hard work. You know, it's just hard. It's flat out hard. It's hard to concentrate. It's hard to come to practice. But they don't hand out playoff berths in the MIAC. I've told you that before. And every group that we have had, at least when we've come and gotten blown out, you know, we've at least got it together and used it as feedback, you know, and tried to make something good out of it. Because when you get knocked down, like I've told you before, you've only got two things to do. You can get discouraged or you can get determined. I mean, you can go through your regular grievance stuff and all that kind of jazz, but when it's time to hit the floor tomorrow, you should be very determined, saying, this was just kind of unacceptable, and that shouldn't happen again. You know, I can stomach somebody, guys, flat out coming out and beating us. You know, just flat out beating us. God, there's nothing that we could do. And we had a couple of games like that where I couldn't they just were above us, period. It's a little tougher for me to stomach coming someplace and losing. And by that, the implication is there are things that we could control out there.
Seemingly, Carleton took the advice to heart. That Saturday, on the road, they defeated St. Mary's 73-59 and headed into winter break with a 2-1 record in the MIAC. Carleton, a school whose members seem to pride themselves on their often eccentric air, takes the same approach in the design of its academic calendar. Students are on winter break from before Thanksgiving to after New Year's. And for the most of the school's 1,800 students, most of whom hail far away from Minnesota, it's a pure unadulterated recess. But for the winter athletes, meaning men's and women's basketball players, wrestlers, and select swimmers and skiers, it's more like a glimpse into the life of a pro. And from the time the Hawaii trip ends and December's 3 conference games are played until the school shuts down for Christmas and New Year's, it's little more than practice, films, and a whole lot of free time alone on campus.
I had autographed pictures of Chris Jackson, Kenny Anderson. I had all team pictures from Syracuse and all in these media guys, and then just gives the sports information director's name, and I just go through and find the teams I like, and I write to them and say I'm doing a basketball preview.
But for the coach and his family, there's even less downtime during break.
I can kind of answer that, what you've asked ask Chris about what's it like. It was 3 years, we were in our third year at Carleton before I realized that Carleton was on break from Thanksgiving to New Year's Day, because I got up and went to work, Guy got up and went to work, and it never occurred to him to tell me that they were on break. And one day another Carleton faculty member said to me, "So how's Guy enjoying his break?" And I said, "Oh, did you have break today? I thought maybe a day off." And he said, "Well, you know, break." And I said, "No, I didn't know what he was talking about." And then he explained that you had been on break from Thanksgiving to Christmas. And I said, "You're kidding." And I didn't know that. And I said, "Is this new this year?" He said, "No, it's been this way forever." And I said, "You're kidding." And so, no, things don't change. He still goes to the office every day at 7:30 and comes home at about 7:30.
Explain your break schedule here.
You mean guys like before since we returned?
Yes.
Oh, hell. That's basically hell. 2 days each day, two times each day, but those first 3 days were brutal. Just terrible. Not to mention all the food that we failed to get. Sandwiches. Sorry, excuses for sandwiches for lunch, no breakfast.
What's this? This is the
every day. God.
Big sandwiches.
I'm getting Cheetos today, damn it. I get Cheetos.
Did you sense any frustration out of either Brett or Jordan at all?
I think I sense frustration about everybody in the program during, you know, specific things that are taking place. But as far as any anything brought up to me, other than, you know, Jordan wanting just a good evaluation of how I had seen his progress and that kind of stuff, I mean, golly, what competitor doesn't want to be playing? Or who? And if you're seventh man in averaging 18 minutes, who doesn't want to be a starter? If that's your position, you know, you're constantly aspiring, you know, to improve, and that's part of being a competitor, you know. But as far as just flat out sensing or being approached on, you know, unhappiness or anything like that, no.
Not long after, Red Edelman left the team.
It's my girlfriend in the backseat complaining. I don't know why I put up with it. I shouldn't.
Now, tell me about what we're going to see here. What are we going to...
We're going to see oodles of people. I'm guesstimating like 30-ish people. My dad said 96 on the phone, but there's not 96. So we'll go on in. I'll introduce people as we go along. This is our garage. It's all full of junk. Yeah. And we're going inside. Hey, there's a...
I got Kevin to you.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
This is my nephew Ben. I'll wave to Ryan, the cameraman.
The role of the family in a child's athletic life is something we wanted to capture. As we suspected, each player drew different levels of support from his family. We looked for evidence of this as the season progressed.
Okay,
what story can we tell about?
This is my family.
Doing? Well, I want to hear about what you think about the game tonight.
Oh, we think about it?
Yeah. What did you think about the rivalry or anything?
Oh, okay, I'll tell you what. I didn't even know about it. I knew there was a game, but I didn't know who they were playing, and I didn't know it was a rivalry.
Okay,
so.
All right. That's cool.
Sorry. I should, but...
Oh, well, that's fine.
I don't even want to talk.
I think with the new coach, Kosmoski, and I don't think Carleton has a chance tonight. It's going to be a tough game, but I think... You're always going to win. So
how much? Give us a score.
I'm seeing 80. Chad Boger's just going to get lit off tonight, I'm telling you. Weber and Schilling went to his – we're both from Hopkins, and they're going to show Boger how to play some basketball. So I'm saying maybe 85, 78, 7-point win.
All right.
This is a thing the cross-country team has passed on from year to year. They take it to every St. Olaf Carleton basketball game and cheer, you know, and it up.
Holy suck!
Thank you. 1914, two St. Olaf students decided that the already decade-old rivalry with Cross River rival Carleton needed a trophy. And what they made out of scrap wood and broom bristles was supposed to be a goat. But whatever they came up with, its intrinsic value was immediately priceless. And since then, Carleton and St. Olaf Colleges have played twice yearly for the Goat Trophy. It just may be the longest continuous rivalry in all of college hoops. And that's why we were fairly disappointed with a somewhat mixed reaction on both campuses about this night's game to be played at Carleton. For several years straight, the Knights had kept the goat on Carleton's side of the river, and only a season sweep by St. Olaf would produce a forfeit of the prize. This game tonight, in other words, is a season unto itself, a chance for both programs to showcase what they had to offer.
It was against this backdrop of excitement that we learned some disturbing news. Nick Brown, for reasons unknown at the time, had suddenly left the team. A collective gasp went through the entire program. What would Carleton do now without its starting center and arguably best player? We didn't need to wait long for an answer. St. Olaf was waiting.
With Jake and Adam now replacing Brown, we watched as the Knights, suddenly one of the league's smaller teams, struggled to find their offense. But while it wasn't pretty, it was intense, and the Knights scratched their way to a 3-point lead at the half.
And then when we run it right here, Tom, your picking position has been perfect. Don't go any higher than that. And Chad, if he goes over the top, we should be able to set it over the top. Jim, if you're in the four and you're popped out here and that kid's playing down here, the play's over. The ball is shot. Okay.
The St. Olaf game attracts more attention than any other game throughout the year. With Nick's situation thrown in, we were scrambling to capture it all. So as the Knights received halftime instructions, we looked for insight into Brown's departure.
All I know about it is that the custodian this afternoon told me that, asked me what kind of day Guy was having, and I said, why? Something happened, and he said that he heard Nick Brown quit. And I asked Sully, and Sully said, yeah, that's true, but didn't know any reasons, and I don't know any reasons. And
I was sorry to hear about Nick Brown dropping out. I mean, that's really tough, I can imagine. But the problem is when you got to turn around your whole offense and your whole defense with a key guy gone.
Yeah.
And I thought they really looked ragged the first 5 minutes of tonight. And how much of it was that? But they really came together very well, I thought.
Like I said, it's Division III, and as long as it's fun, then you keep playing. But as soon as it's not, you don't want no farther.
Yeah.
In the middle of it all, we ran into a blue chip recruit.
Josh Wilhelm.
I'm Ryan. How are you? Are you a Carleton recruit or Olaf?
Kind of both.
kind of checking them out.
So who invited you here to this one?
Coach Callan invited me to this one.
Well, that's kind of why I'm here. Learn a little bit about the rivalry, I guess. See a little bit about both teams. Yeah. I know Carleton has a real strong team this year, but as far as I can tell, Coach Kosmoski is a real good coach, so, you know.
Without Brown's presence inside, the Knights now needed to learn how to run, and run they did. The team's transformation from a half-court big man offense into a run-and-gun show was amazing. It was, in fact, the story of the year. But the wings of flight were fragile at first, and quite often the running was sloppy at best.
Using solid perimeter shooting, the Knights extended their lead midway through the second half. but they couldn't quite put away the Scrappiolis, who used a gritty defensive effort to claw their way back to a tie with 3 minutes to go. We could see in Linda's face, yet another Carleton-Olaf matchup would go down to the wire.
It seemed fitting that Tom Klimisch got the steal that sealed the win in the battle for his hometown. And the Knights escaped with a 60-57 win. They were now 3-1 in conference play.
Carleton now journeyed into the middle part of the season, their goal of making the playoffs well in sight. But their new look, new style offense needed practice. They needed to learn how to fly.
All alone, and the sun went down, as across the hill, and the town lit up. The world got still. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days may not return, and the rocks might melt, and the seed may burn. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Some say life will beat you down and break your heart, steal your crown. So I started out for God knows where. I guess I'll know when I get there. Learning to fly around the clouds. What goes up must come down. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. I'm learning to fly.
We gotta go with what you got, you know. We have a lot of small guys and we like to run.
I'm not unimpressed with the effort, you know, that the team has. And like I told him after, you know, Nick's decision, you know, golly, I mean, there have been times when I've been at Carleton where we've been without talent. You know, this isn't one of them.
I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings.
coming down is the hardest thing. Will beat you down, break your heart, steal your crown. So I started out for God knows where. I guess I'll know when I get there. Learning to fly around the clouds. What goes up must come down. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. I'm learning to fly around the clouds.
With just 7 games left, the Knights found themselves in a tie for third with St. John's University. Carleton was 10-7 overall, 9-4 in league play. Eric Furch led the team in scoring. Ken Coblin ranked high in the nation for his 3-point marksmanship, and the team was undefeated in 7 games at home. But things were still evolving. Freshman Jim Lovren now started at forward over juniors Jake Nelson and Adam Mickelson, and senior Tom Klimisch had greatly increased his role. So the team began February, the playoff dream still alive, with tough squads like St. Olaf, Concordia, and undefeated St. Thomas looming ahead. Finally, hoping to close the book on his decision to leave the team, we approached Nick Brown.
If you had 5 words to describe why you left, could you do it?
Yeah, I didn't enjoy basketball. Well, it didn't have anything to do with the program. I don't think I could find a better program. It just was. There were other things in my life that became more important. I felt like basketball was taking away from other things. I felt like I was defined by basketball. It wasn't something I did, it was what I was, and I didn't like that. And I just wasn't having fun. I didn't enjoy practicing. I didn't enjoy games. I didn't get excited for games. I didn't want to win, and it just wasn't the thing for me to be doing. It was too big a commitment.
Basketball is not my life. I don't want to make it my life. I have a lot of things that are more important in my life. And so, you know, the incredible time commitment and just knowing that I'm going to have to come here every day, and maybe that's going to take opportunities away of doing other things, that gets a little frustrating, especially this time of year when everyone's back. You know, you got schoolwork you got to get done too, and then it just gets a little annoying sometimes.
Yeah. What do you think? How do you react to that?
I agree. I think that we all have different levels of commitment to the game. I think Jake and I are a little different in that sense. I mean, I like to come out and play. Sometimes I admit I really get sick of it sometimes. It's like I really needed the last Thursday off because my legs were just shot. I needed a day of rest.
You know, I think I get my saturation of athletics more than a lot of people do, as a matter of fact. You get stereotyped when you're a coach. People just assume, I mean, if I had a nickel for every person downtown Northfield, I'm like, oh, how did you enjoy the Super Bowl? Like, oh, what did you think? Well, you know, I didn't watch it, actually. You know, you what? You know, what's it? We went to a movie. Or, you know, I like doing other things. London, Abby, and I going to the to watch Phantom of the Opera, or next week going to see the Lipizzan Stallions, and a lot of different things like that. So I think I really plug into what I believe my job is, and I do that with enjoyment. I can't wait to get to the office in the morning. And if I were to not be associated with athletics at all, mm-hmm. it would be in, I think, in some sort of educational type of a thing, or maybe even sales.
I didn't really notice, but now that you mention it, Jake definitely comes in around the middle, but it's definitely the first one out.
Yeah, I'm the first one out.
Who's the last one in?
Tom, usually.
Tom or Chad, yeah.
Tom or Chad, yeah.
Who's the first one in?
Sam.
Sam, definitely.
You see the last
He's
one?
He's the gung-ho freshman.
Those freshmen are all kind of like that. You can tell they're freshmen, too, because you know, they'll stay and shoot free throws after practice and stuff. Which is a good thing, but...
Okay, what do you think about college hoops so far?
I don't know. It's a lot different than high school. Just from the fact we went to a high school Northfield Faribault game last night. There's cheerleaders, you know, and a pep band, and a lot of fans. And some of our games, like the MAC game, there weren't very many people here. And at first, that kind of bothers you, but now it's starting to get to the point where you just play the game just to do it well and because you like to play.
Yeah, definitely from a fan standpoint and a school spirit standpoint, here at Carleton at least, it's not as much as you had we had in high school, but you have to find ways of, at least I have, of hyping myself up for a game and getting prepared for a game mentally without the encouragement of the cheering fans and the bands and the cheerleaders and so forth. But I've adjusted to that pretty well. And as far as the game.
Excellent.
Carleton is a member of the NCAA's Division III, which means the students receive no scholarships for their athletic endeavors. Any funding they do receive to defer the school's $25,000 yearly price tag is based solely on their family's financial needs. What this means is that the players are out there simply because they like playing ball. Not many go on to the pros. Then again, not many miss receiving their degrees.
What do you like most about getting to cover this Division III?
Oh, I, you know, just guys like you are great students and put your academics ahead of athletics, and you had a good athletic experience, and you know, you played at a competitive level, but you went to school for all the right reasons. There was no under-the-table payment. You don't read about steroids in the Division III situation. Great schools. I mean, every school in the MIAC is a wonderful school. You know, as a parent, you'd love to send your kids to any school in this conference. And the kids compete very hard, and they work very hard, and they're pleasant, and they're fun to interview, and they're bright, and all those things, all those pluses.
Yeah. And it's not the kind of, it's people, I don't, there are really good players that come into college basketball programs that are maybe even thinking of playing a level higher than ours, and they get here, and just our practices, they can't believe how quick everybody is, how well everybody jumps, how, that everybody can score, and if you don't defend, your guy's got the ball in the basket. I mean, they're usually quite impressed with Division III basketball. A lot of people think, well, maybe they're not a gopher, but they can sure play in the MIAC, and that's not necessarily the case. It takes a great deal of talent and almost an unmatched desire to want to succeed, because the game means something to you, and your image of self and where you want to be headed is a big part of it.
The Carleton basketball season is sandwiched between fall and winter term final examinations. So, as the playoff stretch drive approached for the Knights, so too did the most stressful academic time. In balancing schoolwork, a work-study job, a social life, and all the while keeping a playoff dream alive, proved at times to be a daunting task.
My day is kind of ruined game days because it's Monday and Wednesday especially. I have class until 3 and then I go straight from that to pregame, straight from that to the game. So really to help me get prepared for the game is basically on the bus ride up. That's where I start to focus on the guy that I'm going to be guarding and thinking about the game, thinking about taking a shot, thinking about
different situations in the game. Up until that point in the day, I don't really have time. It's a lot different from high school for me, especially in that aspect.
Like, let's say it's 2 o'clock Wednesday afternoon, you got a game, big game that night. Describe your feeling sitting in class.
Cool. I'm trying to think what I don't really think about it much. I mean, I think maybe I'll think about some plays or just, you know, think about doing something well or anything, but I don't really, it doesn't really hit me that early.
Let's give a shot at that.
For the seniors, there's the added pressure of completing their senior thesis, affectionately known as comps.
What's wrong? What's the problem you come here to just hold me?
Oh, well, you know, right now I should be doing my comps, and I just find myself a little unmotivated right now. I'm going to travel in China this spring on the Beijing seminar, and I have to have my comps done before I leave. But I just got accepted to dental school. You know, I'm pre-med, and so I'm finding it very difficult to want to do my comps.
You know, it gets a little hectic with, you start going, oh my gosh, I have no time with classes and basketball, and you realize that you're spending 3 hours every other day, you know, playing basketball, or 4 hours every other day going to a game, and it becomes a little overwhelming.
How do you think you're doing personally, you know, since Nick's departure?
I'm doing better, personally. My points have gone up, my rebounds have gone up, which is understandable. Personally, I feel I have a more important role now, because, you know, before it's like, well, Nick's here, so I don't have to, you know, worry as much, you know, about guarding the big guy or making a block shot that needs to be made. But since he's gone, there's a lot more responsibility on me to score, but more importantly, rebound.
Score and rebound he did. Tom Klimisch confidently stepped into the cavernous shoes left behind by Nick Brown and provided a steady inside game that perfectly complemented the Knights' new run-and-gun style. So successful was he, in fact, that on this night he surpassed a 44-year-old Carleton single-game scoring record and fell a mere 1 point shy of breaking the MIAC record.
Oh, what a night. Late December, back in 64. What a very special time for me. I can't remember what a night. Oh, what a night. You know I didn't even know her name, but I was never gonna be the same. What a lady, what a night.
Oh, I got a fuzzy feeling when he walked in the room. And I, as I recall, it ended much too soon.
Oh, what a night! Hypnotizing, mesmerizing. She was everything I dreamed she'd be. What a lady, what a night.
I felt the rush like the rolling for the thunder, spinning the head around, taking the body under. Oh, what a night.
Nice game.
Give me a hug before I have to go home.
Oh, it's so much fun. Good job. Woohoo! It'll last forever.
I hope so.
Game time.
Try and hustle a little bit more.
Yeah. All we can hear was your coach going, hustle, Tom.
We need a little bit
Tom.
More point production out of you, Tom. Good game. Good guy.
Shot!
While the win over McAllister was impressive, the week prior, the Knights' playoff hopes, and not to mention their pride, suffered a serious blow in the rematch with St. Olaf. This time, Carleton blew an 8-point lead in the final 2.5 minutes. Ken Coblin again took the deciding shot, much as he did against Pomona. But this time, it fell the other way, and Carleton lost 69-68. Fortunately, Carleton's closest rival for the final playoff spot, Gustavus Adolphus, also lost that week. But for Coblin, a senior playing in his final games, falling to the Olies was especially difficult.
I felt horrible.
I felt terrible.
That's a team you should have beaten. Like, that's the only real game that I cared about, and that we lost. Actually, I don't usually care that much about losses, but I can't get over that, you know? You know, I'm a senior, and it's the last hurrah, and I'm not that worried about practicing once more. You know, I want to play as much as I can because I'm about to never play organized basketball again.
Oh, man.
I know, isn't that weird?
It's weird, really weird.
I mean, I will never really play good basketball. It disgusts me to play dune ball, so what am I going to do? So, you know, I want to make the playoffs. I don't want to be part of the crowd that... No, but how many years have we been in the playoffs now? 5.
Is it?
Yeah, and I don't want to be part of a group that messes that up. Because you think of the seniors when you think of the year.
Uh-huh.
You know? That would be kind of embarrassing.
Later that week, after beating Augsburg at home, Carleton traveled to Moorhead and lost to third-place Concordia. But they turned it around the next week and won twice, including Tom's historic performance at McAllister. So now, in fourth place, with just 2 games left, it all came down to this. Win, even just once, and they were in the playoffs. But lose twice, and they would need a Gustavus loss to sneak in the back door. And with 8th place Hamlin on tap first, and then 1st place and undefeated St. Thomas in the season finale, this appeared to be Carleton's best shot at getting in on their own accord.
We can't let them get a start, right? No easies, organized on the offensive end, so they've got to attack our structured up defense 5-on-5 on the other end of the floor. We need to own the dead ball situations, right? Offensively and defensively. We need to recognize everything that's going on the floor. As I mentioned before, we don't need to play out of our pants today. We need to play good, intelligent, hard college basketball. And then we're going to realize one of our goals 40 minutes from now. You need your best on the court. You need your best when you're on the bench, staying awake, seeing what's going on. Let's do no relaxing until we get back in here after 9 o'clock. Should we get one, guys? Right. Look, everybody, been a long fall, been a long winter. It's all for tonight, right? It's all for tonight. Very determined Carleton team out there. We're all business. We're sharp with the ball. We're sharp on the other end of the floor. Good luck. Have a good time. Take your pride out there. Let's get it done. Top team!
Come on, guys. Take care. But Hamlin's swarming defense, led by number 4, Matt Owney, had other ideas about Carleton reaching its playoff goals.
Help me, quick! Yeah. Come here! Well!
fact, the first half went so poorly, we were asked to leave the locker room just before the halftime talk.
Whatever was said, it worked for a while. Carleton clawed its way back, cutting the Hamlin lead to just 6 points. And for a minute, there was a feeling of, yes, we're going to do it this time. But it just wasn't meant to be. Hamlin pulled away and ended up winning by 7, 95-88.
It was now a one-game season. The team still held its playoff destiny in its own hands. Win and they advance. Lose and they would need a Gustavus loss to St. John's. But a win wouldn't be easy. In town for this final regular season game were the undefeated, nationally ranked St. Thomas Tommies. We looked to the seniors for insight.
I don't want to bring up a sour point, but I think it's early enough in the evening to forget about
it.
But this could be it.
It could, yeah. You know, I've thought about that, and I don't feel bad if I don't feel bad. Yes, I'd feel bad if we lose and we didn't make the playoffs. I can handle losing fine, but if we make the playoffs, you know, it's no big deal. But if we lose and then Gustavus happens to be St. John's, it's like, ooh, it's kind of different because you're expected to make the playoffs. It's a Carleton tradition to make the playoffs. And
comps?
Comps, man. I'd like to tell you with St. Thomas today that I've been sitting around mentally preparing myself for the game, but that's really not the truth. Instead, I'm adding the 80 to 90 footnotes I have for my comps. Doesn't it seem like 80 is too many?
Well, what do you have to do to beat this team?
Play hard, play consistent. You know, set up our game on the offense, you know, set up our pace. Patience with the ball, you know, work it through. If we run through our offense, you know, we'll have an open shot every time.
Oh! Nervous?
Yeah. Last home game? No, we haven't lost at home. We could lose tonight.
Don't worry about it. Could win tonight, too.
Yeah.
What would you feel like if you just beat it, you went on and took it to the Tommies?
And that'd be so cool, because, I don't know, they're undefeated, and just to ruin their season, their perfect record, I'd just love to be a part of that. And I don't know, just feel like, you know, last year we lost here by 40 to those guys, and that's just disgusting. I can't lose by 40 at home. And it's my last home game, so.
So, okay, yeah, this could be it.
Yeah, this could be it.
What do you sense, or how do you coach a team? How do you coach a team when that's the case? How do you keep it focused?
I think just that in itself and just good preparation for the ball game and not getting a lot of collateral thoughts into the mind other than just, you know, hey, we've been pretty successful at the West Gym. Not only have we won 9 straight, there's only been 2 teams to come within 15 points of us here. You know, we should be a confident Carleton team, and I think they are. I address the fact that I thought we more or less let them off the hook up their place. And I'm not unrealistic about how good this team is. Obviously, this is really a good team, but it's not a yikes, it's the Tommies. It's a great opportunity, and I don't try to sell them that. I believe that. I mean, I'm very excited about the tip-off of the game and getting in with the adjustments and that kind of stuff and a lot of fun. And I think our guys have shown some good, consistency maybe even with bouncing back off of modest performances. And with all due respect to Hamlin, who played real well, I expect it to be a very excited Carleton team tonight.
key matchup would be Carleton freshman Eric Furch versus Tommy sophomore Carnell James. All year long, Furch had been assigned with shutting down the opposing team's star, and all year long, he had done a remarkable job. But in the team's first meeting, James burned Carleton for a game-high 29 points. Tonight's task would not be easy for young Furch to complete.
Playing out just as it should. Hard fought with very few easy buckets. And the battle between Furch and James was proving classic. Neither one could get on a roll. Carleton went into the break up by 5.
Every time I cut somewhere, I'm open, you're looking the other way, then you
perhaps sensing just how close they were to reaching their goal, the players were unusually upbeat in the locker room at the half.
First got the ball, take it out and get it in.
Yeah, whoever takes the ball out of the net, you get it, and you sit in the channel and just scream or yell your name.
Because once they set it up, we're screwed.
If he gets into that much trouble.
This side right now, Chad, on the line press breaker, we've got 5, wing, 4. And 4, we're doing this, right? And 5, we're stepping in here and getting my butt right to the sideline, and I am driving off that hard here. And 5, right after that screen, I don't want us X-ing, I want us rolling right straight back so that we can get the ball and get it back to our one guard.
When Carnell is away from the basketball, he's on the other wing, Sam, don't keep trailing him again.
Here's the wing with the ball and 2 things. And it's hard, Sam, because they're reversing the ball as he's cutting and we're kind of Velcroed onto him. But the other thing, I'm not sure, Chad, if it was your man right here, but Carnell was coming away like this and then turning around and you stepped up and kind of bumped him a little bit, which is really good. Are you with me on what we're talking about? Hey, if I'm one of the wings out here and Carnell is coming and we're chasing him because the ball just got quick swung to that side, hey, switch, got him, mine. Right? Because he's coming towards what? Coming towards the ball. And you're not going to get hurt, I don't think, with the roll-off stuff when they've got postman coming in there and he's looking to curl right there. Anything else? Captains, any other observations out there? Got some shots that I like that I
heard
in the second half.
Keep rebounding.
Let's relax and let's get the ball in the basket. All about effort out there, right, guys? It's all about effort. Beat him to the ball. Tough D.
Catch the rebounding, guys. Match him, Tommy.
But the Knights were perhaps too keyed up opening the second half, and it showed. UST quickly closed the gap. Oh,
But the battle between Eric Furch and Carnell James was still heating up.
Glue on him, Eric!
Despite that acrobatic steal, for the most part, Furch and James canceled each other out. That left room for others to shine. In Carleton's case, it was Chad Boger, who led all scorers with 20 points.
But St. Thomas wouldn't quit. Showing why they were undefeated, they took a 3-point lead late into the ballgame.
Chad, as we come over the top with the flare, Eric, if it's clean, it goes, right? If I'm pressured, I can drive it. Chad, you need to stop your spacing in the middle third of the floor. Jim, after the flare, you step out at wing extended area right here. So, Eric, you've got a throwback, and if you hit rush, and our feet are organized, and we're ready for three.
The Knights drew up a play that called for a freshman, either Furch or Lovren, to take the crucial shot. The three-pointer didn't go, but Tom was fouled and awarded two shots with a chance to pull within one. On the ensuing play, the Knights foul Carnell James to stop the clock.
Huddle them up! Tell them what they're doing! Huddle them up! Tell them what they're doing here! Same thing!
James calmly sank both shots, putting the lead back to three. So now, the fate of the season lay in one final rush up the West Gym court.
The Knights now had only one more chance to make the playoffs, a Gustavus loss. They could only wait and hope.
Things will come our way. Go find out right now.
Yes, is the game over yet? '81-'68 with 50 seconds left? Okay, thanks a lot. Bye.
Who's winning?
Gustavus. 81-68 with 50 seconds left.
Everybody here, boys.
Well, good ball game, guys. It looks like Gusty has things pretty well in hand over in the other court, so that pretty much wraps it up. And you know, tough night, but you know, not bad basketball. It was fun to watch you play, and you played with a lot of stuff, and they did some nice things down the stretch, and that's why they are where they are. We do have people waiting for us, and we can, you know, commiserate and talk about some things at another point in time, but I think right now we just need to get our chins up and go shower up and help thank some of the people who have been in real good support, from our administrators to everybody else, to help us get to where we are / were, or whatever it might be. But really a nice effort tonight, and Ken and Tom, you guys have just been a superb 4-year Carleton Knights from a practice standpoint of being around, and Ken, thanks a lot. And it was neat, and Tom, same sort of thing. It'll be sometimes bigger memories as time goes on and stuff, and hope you enjoyed the sweat. So I'm sure I'm talking for the team when I say thanks a lot, and why don't we all get our heads up, get showered up, and we get up to Great Hall and meander with some people. Get your hands in here, Knights. Good effort, boys. Nice work tonight. Good job. Tough D.
Congratulations, Tom.
Funny thing about athletics, you prepare, plan, practice all year long to prolong the season, but think not for a minute about the end. It's really unfair. Preseason is a slow build filled with painful learning, but the end, it arrives almost unseen and most often unwelcome. Just as your body becomes used to the grind, just as your mind becomes used to the routine, and just as your heart becomes addicted to the plane, it all stops. No more practices, no more meetings, no more games. It's as though you are just borrowing the lifestyle for a few months, and then its owner takes it back unannounced. So you'd better have left it all out on the court. In college hoops, do-overs don't exist.
But another funny thing is this. As we found out, the end is what you make of it. There's always another season, just a few months away. Some say the season never ends. For this team, not making the playoffs was disappointing. Why? Because the program has come to expect that much. But this team was young. With new recruits, they would be back. And even for Tom and Ken, their next season was soon to come as well. It just wouldn't take place on a basketball court. And as for the two of us, who at the time were both coming to grips with the end of our own athletic careers, following this team was a catharsis. In fact, it was our next season. And soon, each of the young men on this team would be faced with their own next seasons as well. How would they perform? The response to that, until time answers, is truly more than we know.
Maybe somewhere down the road you'll think of me and wonder where I am these days. Maybe somewhere down the road when somebody plays Purple Haze.
Well, it's alright, even when push comes to shove. Well, it's alright, as long as you got someone to love. Well, it's alright, everything'll work out fine. Well, it's alright, we're going to the end of the line.
Don't have to be ashamed of the car I drive. I'm just happy to be here, happy to be alive. And it don't matter if you're by my side, I'm satisfied.
Alright, even if you're old and gray, well it's alright, you still got something to say. Well it's alright, as long as you live and let live. Well it's alright, the best you can do is forgive. Well it's alright.